90% of them will never attend a live event. Brands are spending $19.2 billion a year, which is COVID candidates. There's a problem. Broadcast viewing viewership on broadcast TV is a problem. 20% since 2011. Now, brands are leaving broadcast because they're trying to find better audiences. Few services headlines, like ESPN, lost 10 million subscribers over the past 3 years, $750 million in subscription revenue. So it's a problem we can solve with fans here by using interactive. We create fans here, founder and fan chief of fans here. We created fans here as a way to connect brands with passionate fans during live sports broadcasts. But what we do that is we inject interactive competition to synchronize with the live game matchup during the broadcast. In doing so, we give fans, really passionate fans, a more engaging experience, more in the fourth wall, bringing them into the live game matchup. We give broadcasters a larger, more engaged, and highly matchable audience, or we give advertisers a way to reach a targeted fan base via mobile devices. Our technology platform is embedded in 16 different events for 2,000 users. We've got a strategic relationship with game clusters. We're negotiating right now with the regional sports bar franchise over in the Kenya area, and we're also working on a relationship with Alphabet's sponsorship partnership with the Party brand. Our technology platform is embedded and is ready for growth. Now, our global market strategy is to partner with sports bars, bringing that technology platform into the bars, making it a much more engaging environment. We'll cut the difference between the average shelf size by 20%. We use sports bars as a demonstration table for what we can do in the market. Consider fan shooting about the first and second line for our fan. It's a long experience, so you're going to see on screen where your eyeballs are. You're going to see the interactive engagement, true competition, true engagement, show up on top of the broadcast. And also, you're going to see the same thing on the mobile device. And that's how we capture the fan club engagement. It's loudly more and more engaged more as your team's home. And when your team's fans win that competition, you're going to award for them. A good market strategy for partnering with sports bars. It only takes 40 units to get to actual positive. We'll do that in this year. And then we'll pivot and focus all of our efforts towards broadcast engagement. We're seeing 550K. We've got 40% of that already committed. That's a $19.2 billion one. And one more from brand one more broadcast, one more team technology.
Thank you. Any further questions from Jim and Brian?
You started out by mentioning that fans aren't watching, right?
Right.
We're losing them.
Right.
But then veered into a brand relationship with fans. I never heard what is going to engage them when to start watching.
So the interactive competition, where as you're watching, you're going to be talking to a lot of people
the people who are watching. You're not bringing in.
So what we do for the benefit of the broadcasters is by making that a more engaging experience, you're more inclined to watch. So millennials are the ones who are not getting this $150 cable package because they don't like the passive experience. They're global iPads and Xboxes. They want something to engage. I want to be a part of the entertainment experience.
What research or neuroscience relates to where we come from? What is it that makes people feel engaged?
Are you supposed to?
Hi.
Okay. So, have you ever cheered while you're watching? Okay, a little bit better. So, you're not really supposed to. I'm going to turn my attention to the real sports fan. But a passionate sports fan is going to cheer and yell at the screen while they're watching the game on TV. I ask everyone, how do you do that? Because I feel like I'm a part of that experience. So, now we've taken this intangible action and made it tangible. I'm metricing your fan engagement. What kind of fan are you? So now we can take this passive, I've got a jersey, I've got makeup on, I'm cheering gun, but now there's something tangible. I can say, I out cheered you, right? And that's a whole other dynamic to fandom. but it's never been tried before.
So I've actually been in earlier iterations of this business twice. First was with Sport Vision years ago, but I don't want to. He actually tried to do some of this stuff as well, but I didn't go back to that. And then he go about the back group because the Fox, this is 2000, so it's a while ago.
Global?
Yeah, you know, Global was sort of a global But I found that it makes me change. I mean, perhaps because we were even talking about it now, but the industry certainly have a deep set of the four major sports in the U.S. Assuming we're talking about those, but that's about it. Okay. What of those, what discussions have we had about it? Is NBA, you know, usually baseball, hockey league, and football are all highly protected as we didn't describe. They will not be, I'm not talking about one bar, but down in 20 or 200, they will absolutely reject that and try to find a way to shut that down if it comes in on the side. So the question is, have you talked to the leaders and such yet? Can I get them, you know, it's 10.2, plus 2004, because if you're not in partnership with them, it's the major sports what the action would you expect from them?
So we had that discussion with the team, and what we found that teams are very protective of buses. So they don't want to make the home viewing experience any better.
And they can't step outside of the police.
Correct, and I can't. So what we do find is the challenge for the broadcasters. So take ESPN, for example. They're going to have to modify the $25 billion contract they just signed with the NBA. 2021, they're going to be the same move they had. So if I'm a broadcaster or value proposition by offering the advertiser, I charge them more practice based on production. Especially when I have a leadership.
Okay, we gotta move on. Thank you very much, Greg. This mic is working just fine. So I'd like to introduce Robin. I'm Robin Gruber, and I'm the CEO of Parkcar. I want you to raise your hand if you've ever had trouble finding a street parking spot. Okay, as you can see, most of the hands in the room are raised. So roughly 30% of the cars on the road today are circling the block looking for parking, which leads to traffic, congestion, pollution, and lots of frustrated people. So I've created Parkcar, which is a mobile app that connects drivers looking for parking spots with those needing their parking spots. So how it works, so let's say Jim is parked outside in his pink Prius, and he is leaving tonight at 8 p.m. He can post his spot on the app. And then another driver, let's say Brian, is driving along in his white Honda Civic, could request his spot. Now Jim would get 1 point for hosting his spot, and he could use that point to find the spot. Each of the drivers gets the other driver's car profile, and you're following them on GPS 15 minutes before the swap. Our metrics. To date, we have about 15,000 downloads, 3,000 monthly active users, 20,000 spots hosted, and 15% of those spots have been requested and exchanged successfully. We've received great media coverage from NPR's How I Built This podcast. We're on CBS 2 News, and we were nominated as one of Fast Company's World-Changing Ideas of 2017. The parking market is huge. $100 billion is spent worldwide on parking, one-third of that on street parking, and two-thirds of that on garage parking, so we can essentially tap into both of these markets. China, in particular, is the largest auto market currently, with 180 million vehicles on the road and 50 million parking spots. And they have a huge pollution problem. You see people wearing masks there. So we can help them become more efficient in this space if we were to bring it up. How much are you raising? Because time's up. We're looking to raise $1 million in a seed round. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. And the judges, questions?
Which market are you focused on initially, New York or China?
So right now we're focused on the New York market.
Okay. So it's primarily urban centers that really need this.
Yeah, we'd say our main market is metropolitan cities, but then there's a huge opportunity in college campuses. People are late for class, miss tests, and it's scheduled. You know, when you're leaving class and going to class, you change seamlessly.
So do you post that there's an available spot? Choose who you're going to provide it to? And how do you choose or how do you curate all the people who may want that one spot?
So right now it's up to the users to host their spot, and the incentive is that they get a point, and then they use that point to find the spot. Eventually, we're going to incorporate artificial intelligence using Bluetooth and your accelerometer in the car, so it knows when you're leaving a parking spot.
And you say you have 10,000 users, are they all paying right now? Or 99?
No, we haven't launched a subscription model yet because we want to grow to critical mass, and then we're going to launch a subscription model in late August.
So how many active users do you have today?
3,000.
3,000.
Yeah, monthly active users.
And relative to the point I made before, how do they create? I don't understand how they can find just one person who may be actively looking, so they have a match and who also has an app. Everybody has to download the app and you're an active participant.
Yeah, the thought is that everyone's going to be an active participant, similar to Waze. It's a community, and then again, you get the points by hosting your spot. So you start out with 5 points. So if you search for a spot, take a spot 5 times, that's it.
You so it's up to that view of road rage, 3 or 4 people want to take a spot.
So once I request a spot from you, it turns black, and that is a black car. And then we're in exchange, and no one else can take it. Thank you very much. Thank you. It actually is an episode. So good morning, everyone. So I'm going to thank you for our way to introduce her and you are looking for the next interview. And in particular, you are looking for the special guest person who created the whole city and sections. As well as if it was your favorite TV show and you just wish that you could have a shot to write or producer. To maybe alter the scene or maybe put place in mind some particular place throughout the storyline. Well, let me introduce you to Episode. Episode is a place where TV networks go to discover fresh audience testing content. I like to describe Episode as IMDb meets LinkedIn meets video. And in particular, if you're thinking that this is another video streaming platform, well, this doesn't alter your mind because they're not. We just don't have to be a tool that's a destination. So I discovered in my research with my thesis, I discovered the fact that TV networks spend 40% of their marketing budget just to market a TV show that has an 80% chance of failing. With that 80% chance of failing, it is now at a point where, in most cases, it will never see a light of day. So now that the TV 4 is on, in particular with Netflix, Netflix is spending $6 billion a month this year to acquire original content. And with the $6 billion, Netflix is actually going on a full spread lineup in terms of finding original content. So you might be wondering, well, why do we create this platform? Well, I wish that I could say that I was the only one who created the platform, but I got to brag a little bit. As a non-tech founder, I put together an amazing team, and my team in particular, which is here, Greg Sampson is our CTO, who has 25 years of experience as an engineer and also a manager. My background is an expert in operations and strategy management. I also am a graduate of the University of Pennsylvania and executive in at St. Jude's, and I used to also work in Compass. We have Rebecca Rogers, who has experience as a UX design director, and in particular, Megan has an extensive background with the NFL and HBO channel, and this amazing tech team here, which then covers our infrastructure, manages our back-end Google, Smitty, who has a wonderful front-end, who is a wonderful front-end Google, and also we have Bob, Neil Strickland. So nonetheless, with Episode in particular, we wanted to particularly focus on how can we help executives find this great content. Through our research, people with executives and networks, they said, listen, we are just overwhelmed with amount of content and we just don't have enough time to sit through.
How much are you looking to raise?
We're looking to raise $100,000. with 60%, which is what was operating increase in on-site product development, as well as with cloud infrastructure and heavy machinery.
Jim and Brian.
So, when I read this one, which is a good question, short research, I wasn't completely sure. It sounds to me like primarily because of the
Absolutely. So we are using AI technology as well as the social media infrastructure. So in all the cases, a show will not see the full lineup because of the fact that audiences isn't interested. But because we have special IP technology, we can test the storylines to be determined which particular way the show that the audience might be interested in going.
You're using a panel of some sort to make the inspiration decisions?
We're using a panel, we're also using content. So our content creators have a vested interest in this as well. So through your social media platform, we are able to build your fan base and your following. So based off of data metrics, based off of data analytics and algorithms, we are able to determine which particular show will have a greater success outcome as a brand.
Can people come to your site to watch it?
Well, one thing is through the content creator. So again, we have built in social media interactions where it drives up here. So we can connect with social media interactions where we can connect with your following, as well as we're leveraging alumni base. We're currently partnering with the University of Pennsylvania, as well as Drexel University. Those are our go-to market strategy. And we're also looking to approach our production companies to look for that for additional distribution for
each channel. For people to show off creative content that they think they've got?
Well, not necessarily just anybody, because we're not your culture mentors. It's high quality content. We have 90 days of high quality content that we feature on. And so through subscriptions through the alumni relations as well as the content creators.
What's the business model that you pay to be on the site?
Right.
So the licenses that you involve in any business relationship?
Yeah, so we have licensing contract group, which we're currently speaking with the University of Penn, which is an enterprise contract, and then also we have our subscription-based model as well.
Thank you very much.
Great, thank you everyone. Hi, I'm Dennis Adamo, co-founder of Space Out VR, and I want to congratulate everybody on their new arrival into the immersive era. So Space Out VR is a free-to-play MMO that's a massive multiplayer online game where we create a virtual reality space station on your smartphone by scanning your social media with IBM Watson and a few other tricks. Once you have the space station, you're in orbit with thousands of other spaces. You can visit them, you can leave comments, you can share voice messages, you can favorite them, and most of all, you can share their digital persona in space. Now, we've been producing Space Out VR since 2015. We started out as a music virtualizer and transformed into a sociable VR application. This was an important step because we've been focused on two primary objectives, creating engagement and retention in VR. Without those two, it will never monetize. Moreover, we're focused on the mobile market, only strictly restricted to Android and iOS using the Google Cardboard SDK. Moving forward, our company has achieved tremendous KPIs. We've gotten over 250,000 downloads. We're now number two on the Cardboard VR library. We're now also tracking incredible engagement statistics. We're on our daily average users are generating sessions of over 18 minutes to 20 minutes per use. And that's because we've added tons and tons of features to this MMO. Not only the social side, which includes communications, but focused on entertainment. Specifically 360 video. We're the only company that has a 360 video playlist that's endless. And it just sources more and more 360 content. That's also a metaphor for our monetization scheme. So where we are in our development phases is we are at a milestone right now of implementation of our revenue via a gaming economy, which is going to allow users to be able to generate space dust or experience points, then convert into in-app purchases by then being able to upload their own personal VR content development, play games together, score high scores, win points, share all sorts of different experiences, and moreover, start generating monetization within this gamified environment. A lot of our team is a very seasoned team. We've been in the digital space since the mid-90s. I'm a serial entrepreneur. I have more corporate finance instructors, and I'm happy and excited to be here today, and definitely looking forward to your questions. Thank you.
Okay, questions?
Sure. Walking through, you know, some of the specifically when you started having some of those companies on that present path, it wasn't that good.
Sure, absolutely. So we MAU, BAU had numbers that fluctuated, but let's go back to 2015. So we launched this as a data app, a strictly a music virtualizer. You pick the song from your music library, you got a tricky kaleidoscopic, sound responsive experience in cardboard pizza box.
I just said none of that was in headsets.
Sorry?
There wasn't headsets.
There weren't any headsets, it was pizza box VR. So on that basis, we instantly gathered like 60,000 organic downloads, much to our surprise, from November to about January. We realized importantly it was lacking one major component of mobile gaming, which was retention. So in order to improve that, we added the second feature, which is a game called Headbangers. It's an endless runner VR poster where you are blasted through a sound responsive environment, again, playing your music connected to, you know, which you have an emotional connection to. That increased retention. The retention for 1, 7, and 30 days went up by 300%. We realized that this is actually an opportunity to continue this pattern. We started adding other features, and that's how we ended up with the social VR MMO, which today has, you know, approximately, so we have 22,000 downloads. We have... So the space stations, right now we have about 25,000 space stations. We have 60,000 active users, but those are people that are retained from old versions. We have 16,000 daily actives right now. We have about 500 MAUs. I'm sorry, monthly active users.
10 seconds.
Right. So you're creating a library, right? You need to build a business, not features.
Yeah, building a business through monetization of these features.
It's content, you're creating all content.
So it's all public domain content.
Got it.
That's right.
Got it.
So it's scanning the web using Watson.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Thank you for having me. My name is Herb Ryan, and I'm presenting on behalf of Bitome. At Bitome, we make hydration monitoring devices to track the hydration state of your body in order to improve patient outcomes and reduce healthcare costs. Specifically, we're addressing congestive heart failure, or CHF. CHF is a chronic disease that costs the U.S. healthcare system $40 billion per annum, $17 billion of which is just for diagnosed patients coming back to the hospital, so readmission services. And we want to eliminate that. And we want to do that by embedding our technology with the patient at home so that they can manage their disease and close that cycle so they don't have to go back to the hospital willy-nilly. Our technology is based on clinical MRI. This is the room-filling, multi-million-dollar machine that you've seen at the hospital. But for the last 6 months, we've actually been in Shenzhen, China, working in the electronics capital of the world, to bring down the size and cost of our product to a level commensurate with individual monitoring. And we hope to launch our product in Q1 of 2018. And we're currently seeking a $500,000 convertible note to fund existing partnership pilot studies. Just closing up here, our team is composed of a veteran cast of deep domain experts and is complemented by medical device and business development pros. At Bitome, we believe that hydration state monitoring can do for congestive heart failure what glucose monitoring has done for diabetes. If you want to learn more about the future of healthcare, please come talk to me. Thank you. I'm Herb Ryan.
Any questions?
Talk a little bit about the specifics of how we do the testing. Is that the sound of testing on MRI?
Absolutely. So when you think of an MRI image, you think of those beautiful kind of black and white images that represent your body. Essentially, that is a representation of how much water is in that individual pixel. So rather than make a 256 by 256 image, we just take one pixel and tracked it in time. So a one-dimensional version of that. So it's a very simplified version of MRI. Yeah, our technology is patented. We have 3 patents on that right now, and we'll be filing more. Exactly. So right now the paradigm is that the Affordable Care Act put in place financial burden on the hospitals such that they now are responsible for these patients coming back again, again, and again, financially.
30 days.
30 days, exactly. Yeah, so we actually want to try to eliminate those costs and by making our service cheaper than just doing nothing.
Sequel of your service.
How does it actually integrate into the MRI?
So the device itself, I'm saying, is based on MRI. It's kind of like a mini MRI sort of thing. It's palm-based, and it goes with the patient at home. So it's remote monitoring.
It's your own hardware product.
Exactly, yes. Yeah, it is connected to the physician via telemonitoring.
So what's the approval process like? It's going to be years.
No, actually, so our device falls into a class one.
Just class one?
Really? Yeah, yeah. So we can actually, that's a matter of paperwork versus class two where we'd actually be diagnosing. So we're providing information about your hydration state. So this kind of fits into that zone that FDA has created, general health and well-being, that Fitbit and others fit into. Essentially, yeah. An at-home version, pulse oximetry meter. Yeah.
Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jordan Zan. I'm the CEO and founder of Shootmark VR. Virtual reality is really strange. Everybody who's black balls in your attention knows there's been a series of fraud incidents that police officers have been doing over the last 12 months. At Shootmark VR, we developed a solution to help police officers be well prepared for that day when they have to make a life to see. Our mission at Shootmark VR is to create a distributed, immersive virtual reality training content that will allow officers to improve their judgment and reduce avoidable incidents and bodies. Our founding team has a great balance of technical and general management talent. I'm a graduate of Columbia Business School, I have a background in management consulting, as well as social enterprise. Founded a graphic security nonprofit called Build Up Behind, which we sell over 3,000 people found on this nonprofit. Our chief technology officer, Chris Chung, is a graduate of NYU's Digital Design Program with specialization in virtual reality. Our COO, Jack Tamara, is a McKinsey alum and also a Columbia Business School graduate. The most interesting thing about the founding team is we all share a common heritage in the US military. Jack and I served in the Marine Corps together, and Chris is actually the nuclear sub-area. So we have a reproducible domain, sea, land, and air actually covered. So Jack is in fact helping out the pilot, I was injured on the ground, and Chris was in the waves. So we've got 113 customer interviews all over the country, from Manhattan, New York, to Manhattan, Kansas, Washington State, Washington, D.C. And we found a couple of problems right now with current training. First off, it's not immersive. Second, it's very infrequent. And finally, there's no systematic track of any of the data. There's no way to be performed. How are we going to solve this problem? We're going to develop a virtual reality content headset based on those difficult policing scenarios, such as dealing with emotionally disturbed persons, domestic violence situations, and car stops. We're going to take these headsets and experiences and place them directly in the precincts. By putting them in the training technology at the police officer's place of work, we reduce facilities costs, transportation costs, overtime costs, and drastically increase the amount of training officers that we can get because it's right at their place of work. Finally, we're going to create an analytics visualization software that will allow managers to track and understand their capability of force. So what does the market look like? In the United States, there's 920,000 police officers, roughly. It's about $1 billion per year to spend on training technology. The Chinese market is the single largest public security market in the world. 4.5 million domestic security officers in China, spending about $2.2 billion per year on training technology. The Chinese market is incredibly attractive to us because, even though it's a larger total number, it's about 1 week per officer working in the United States. So low-cost technology offering for us would be very attractive in the Chinese market. In terms of fundraising strategy, we received a $50,000 grant from the University of Utah as part of the Cohen incubator. We're using that to staff our additional engineering team and then build a product demonstration.
Okay, questions?
So I assume this is all based on the scenarios, right? Of course, people live in the last couple of years, what's happened, you know, there's a way to sell them as part of some material.
this sort of retroactively almost in the existing portion as opposed to the courses we just know which we decided that. So, how much of that plays into your architecture movement and market convention? What I'm getting at is how long does it take to close the deal?
Right, so sales cycle is very long in the business development side. January 2006, the 18 month time mark. We're doing parallel processes right now where we have a sales effort that started right now with a brief amount of sheriff's capacity. And the goal is to have revenue to 10, which would then again allow us to just raise money necessary to start to go into production while we're running the sales process parallel. The word that I got from the past year was once you have a solid demonstration on the drop and a solid production date, you can go to
market. So you're basically the assumption that VR can replace current methodologies and do better for training.
So I wouldn't say that it's going to replace any complementary training service. Right now, it's based on training offering to get into practice qualification and then maybe some additional simulation. We want to see it's going through level qualification, it's going through live action training. We want to have a sense of who you're increasing. So once we go to send in scenario on personal on the best viable situation, and find you as we go out to work integrated with their kind of work as those that send in.
I have to assume that there's a pedagogy here that has to be improved by people who actually do this, right?
Yes.
So what kind of process is there that you have in place that creates a pedagogy of the training and supports it with some kind of battle as it works?
Absolutely. So we're working very closely with consultants myself and building out high-level product report managers or official all their content will come directly out of their global references and they might control that will serve as a blueprint to move on to content. The entire system is going to be on top of that all the time, so you can't
thank you very much.
Now we're operationalizing some essential interaction tickets, naturally. The Facebook was originally a directory for people's profiles to add to meetings and to self-presentation. Snapchat was a private note or a disappearing selfie for that privacy purpose. And Instagram is the best that I can tell, and my feed is just an endless scroll of humble brags. And with projections.io, what we're focused on is did you see that moment? Which is to see things that you both noticed in your entertainment content from the streams you support, Netflix, Amazon, and Hulu, a smart TV app as well as from your computer, that you can just hit the button and it consumes two components. A synchronized connection with the pocket computer that you have in your hand at all times, such that the clip comes down from the stream and into your hand, and B, a network for people to share commentary and reactions, and to basically connect and relate over the entertainment content that they're watching. And so, audiences sharing and connecting and relating leads to the market that we're tackling, which is the $8 billion market in the United States alone, which is entertainment advertising. And so that's going to grow up to over $11 billion by 2020. And the idea being that in that market, attention is such a scarce commodity that virality tends to grab people's attention, and it is the edge that we tend to build in two ways. The first thing to say is that with the data aggregated across providers and really granular data as to what people are upvoting, downvoting, even with distance supervision about what people are looking at in their feed, we can determine a very precise fingerprint of what people's next best content, sponsored content, for instance, should be. So we're getting sponsored content, maybe a movie trailer, directly in front of the audience that it's best going to serve. And then B, we're very proud of our embed with the pending intellectual property, which has a dynamic licensing technology such that if you cut a clip with our app and then you put it into, and then you hit play, people jump from that 15-second clip over to the original content, which could be, going just from the sweet kill scene in Game of Thrones to the actual full battle, you're back into the action. And in the context of the global audience, remember that Tencent has shown 600 million views of Game of Thrones alone. And in that context, we're getting a lot of really enthusiastic responses with the creators that we're partnering with down the, because it benefits everyone in the value chain, from the audience up to the licensors, the networks, and the creators themselves. So on the commercial side, we're exploring partnerships with A24, as well as Crestman Films, who are really excited about what the embed in particular can do to build their audience. We're in beta, we'll be releasing soon, but we're going to launch aggregate to like the public thing in time for Game of Thrones, and we're definitely recruiting more meme lords, which we've I've had some personal experience helping build out an audience for. And so With a wide market opportunity, we're pretty excited how we can turn people's attention into something that they'll be entertained by.
So, I love this. For the investors have given one of the things that I wanted to touch on was the capital condition. Get away with it from my advice that you're saying to me. Not so much a professional on display for securities that I don't think about that. It seems to me that part of those strategies is actually for the originators to get them to grab the device, which if the tech inserts and let you send them out. That's a much harder thing to do with having to be creating a launch library. So, I'm curious if you can have the links.
Sure. So copyright and licensing is a very in-depth topic, of course, but we have both the arrangement that Giphy can derive with the creators themselves, where they specify that it is still a licensor's copyright, and the arrangement, and just given the fact that on YouTube, you know, it's like to compare a quote from like a pop-up scout, like giving out a speeding ticket at the 8500, we prove that by always requiring attribution and ability to jump back into, if you have the license to the content itself, without a fair use of fencing. By coincidence, I worked at an IP litigation firm, which did like the RIA defense, and some more interesting kind of like Apple Health litigation.
Okay, so clarify, you can't touch the original. Are you annotating where the actual segment is of the 15 second minute, 1 minute, or 2 minute, or whatever you decide is the video? But you're not allowed to touch the original. How do you actually send it? How do you annotate it?
How we have the metadata to ask what moment it's taken from.
Yeah.
The video element in HTML5 has that, and for providers which are flash-based, such as HBO Go as opposed to HBO on Amazon Prime, we have the ability to just like do a derivation where it is on the actual slider and calculation of
actually
slider.
Thank you very much.
I'm Anu Stead, and I'm the Chief Creative Officer and co-founder of Liar VR. And we are focused on revolutionizing music technology with VR and AR. When our team first tried out VR, we were struck by how natural a fit it was for music technology. We're also focused on how the first-time experience for music learners of an instrument, they often give up because it's just very hard. So when we came up with this technology, we wanted to make it as accessible as possible and fun so that you could easily create, share, perform your music, and just feel a great reward for that experience. So today, if you're a digital artist, the technology you use is, there's a lot of hardware that you have to produce to care. It's expensive, it's complex to learn, and it might take years to master. And the 2D interface of the software hasn't really changed in the last 20 years. So with Liar, what we've done is we've created software where you can basically use it in space around you. And this changes the experience completely because you can actually see and hear it with 3D positional body. It also means that you can use your full body gestures with virtual instruments. And it just completely changes that experience. We submitted it to the eMotion VR Jam, got first place in 2015. And then we submitted to the HTC Vive Accelerator and were accepted. So we founded our company in October 2016, and we developed the alpha version based in Taipei, Taiwan's headquarters of Vivex between October and March of this year. And we launched our alpha version then. And this year, what we're working on is having a global version, second half this year, porting it to other major VR headsets, and then in 2018, moving into the AR space. Our team includes Dylan Coe, who's the CEO, who comes from a background in development from 18 years, and he was that kid that struggled with piano, but later in life taught himself guitar. And then our CTO, John Ray, is an award-winning music composer, and he invents instruments and performs music. I come from game development, since 2004, I've worked with Disney and Cartoon Network and Sony, and I've been starting experience to the team. So we are looking for a 1.5 million seed round so that we can grow the team and develop this technology further. Our costs are extremely low, based in Taiwan. We have partnerships with MSI Computers, Cooler Master, the hardware base there, and we're also working with Cooler Master, which is a professional audio loop company that works with professional artists.
Love
to
get
the demo if you're interested.
slim, although I've been wrong. The question for you, talk about the demo, talk about the demographics, who you're targeting specifically.
Sure. So we're focusing on sort of professional to hobbyist farmers and musicians, but totally forgot. The freemium version, which is on mobile, is for everyone who consumes music content. So what we're creating is a marketplace so that you can be a creator and you can create content in our premium tools. And also have marketplace for plugins, sort of sound samples, and instruments. And then you can be the consumer end where you experience music in this completely new peer space and get it from the creator. So it's sort of creator side, we have a smaller market, and then the consumer side, a much bigger market.
VR is really here. It's certainly a lot of stops.
Sure. I can give you some data. Right now, Sony has passed 1 million headsets. The Gear VR has passed 5 million. The Vive has passed 500,000. And
often these are usable headsets.
These are consumers that are using them. And it's projected to grow, the market size is projected to grow for VR to 37 billion by 2020 by Super Data in that projection. AR space is projected to grow to 80 billion by 2020. And like Facebook and Google are heavily behind this technology and haven't tried it, and really is transformative and have the potential to change the world. So that's, we're very excited about it and we love using all this technology.
Okay.
Meow. Hello. I'm Christina Pawson, founder and CEO of Canvastree.com. Harvard MBA, McKinsey & Company, EA. I was on a pretty corporate track, but then I had an idea that just sort of quit. Inspired by my kids, together with my co-founder, we started Canvastree.com. And our mission is to make it convenient and fun for kids anywhere in the world to learn a foreign language. There are so many benefits to kids for foreign language learning, and the challenges in school that frankly language classes often start too late, and there isn't enough talk time to truly develop fluency. That's why at Canvastree we offer live, one-on-one video lessons with engaging tutors and our proprietary Canvastree Live learning platform. Through sessions, kids are learning to use the language while they learn about the world. And after sessions, they come back to our Canvastree Hub to practice their new vocabulary with games and activities. We've been getting great traction today. So far, 3,000 Canvastree sessions have been completed in Mandarin and Spanish, and our average monthly run rate is $4,000. Gross margins are north of 50%. But what we get most excited about is the feedback we hear from parents who tell us that kids love Canvastree. We had one dad tell us, and his daughter said she had so much fun doing Canvastree lessons, she forgets she's learning piano. That shows up in our metrics. Average customer revenue to date is $960. And for our top 20% customers, it's over $2,000. We previously raised $475,000, and now we're raising a $1.5 million seed round with $1 million committed and a lead investor. We'll use the money to accelerate our marketing and accelerate to recruiting, including from China, and launch our next language, which will be English. We think the global market for language learning is enormous, and we think language learning for kids is so important. That's why we're committed to being the global leader for language learning for children. Yes.
All right, questions?
What makes it work is a combination of super engaging tutors who we carefully screen and kid test before we hire them, our engaging proprietary curriculum that brings all the best in the web together to make an interactive engaging session for kids, and our proprietary platform that's been designed with the needs of kids in mind.
How do you reach your customers? You're thinking about the kind of approach.
Our customers are parents making the buying decision on behalf of their children. Word of mouth and SEO has been our primary customer acquisition channel to date. We're also building relationships with schools who want to be a trusted company when they refer their kids for language lessons. So we're working with them to offer them a more curriculum and for games as well.
Is that just the role of offering anything behind us? That would be a part of it, or just an alternative?
Very different. And kids learn languages differently than adults do. It needs to be fun, it needs to be interactive. Kids learn languages as they can 5 to 15.
Okay,
Hi, my name is Chen Pingyu, and I'm the co-founder of FIRE. We're a very great combining artificial intelligence and augmented reality. So, when we drive these days, we drive with GPS navigation. So, GPS navigation displays the actual map that's on the smart device. And that's up to the driver to really interpret what's the map route and that corresponds to the road that's in front of the driver. And that can lead to misturns, wrong turns, and safety concerns in terms of interpretation. So therefore, we're creating an augmented reality navigation system with AI safety detections. So what that entails is a small device that's placed on the dashboard with a road-facing camera and a driver-facing camera. The road-facing camera continuously receives a live stream of road, and our deep learning AI technology processes information and displays the road view on the device. So with the navigation route, that's directly overlaid on the road, the driver knows exactly where they're going with the turn. Our AI detection also detects various traffic-related objects that includes traffic signs like the bike, pedestrians, to provide safety warnings so the, in case the driver is not paying attention. This is all part by our very own deep learning breakthrough that's extremely efficient, powerful, and effective. So everything runs in real time using just a few cameras on commodity CPU, which is new, and I can be powered using a standard distributed clock. So that allows the product to be distributed to any driver driving any car or any model. The team includes myself and my friend James. So I am currently a postdoctoral researcher at Harvard University focusing on brain-inspired deep learning. And I have a computational background, a PhD in computational machine learning. And my friend James, he's our software expert. He was a company CEO at a smart online retail company that's generating $20 million in revenue. We're addressing three major markets. That's the navigation market, that's $1 billion. There's also the advanced driver assistance system market, that's $90 billion. And $90 billion market in augmented reality. And specifically, we'll be focusing on the US and Chinese market, as China has nearly as many drivers as there are in the US. So that's very important for us as part of our strategy. So our business model has three major revenue streams. One is our aftermarket device, that's direct sell to consumer. We'll also make a simplified version that can run on smartphones and into the camera. We'll also license our technology to car companies and autonomous vehicles using integrated sensors and their screens. Currently, we're raising our seed round that's $3.5 million to allow us to recruit domain-specific developers as well as data collection, development, and marketing sales. Currently, we have raised about $180,000 in convertible note and we're offering this charge.
Thank you. Questions from the judges?
Very ambitious. So are you pre-product as well, or are you?
So as a company, we're very early stage. We just formed about 3 months ago, but our technology is already ready. So we're just
like product.
Yes, it's based on our own information. Yeah.
Yes. Got it. What is the safety issue that you're trying to solve?
So the safety issue is that there are about, so people tend to not pay attention, even though they are driving. So that occasional use of attention causes 1.3 million deaths every year and 20 to 50 million injuries every year. So that, our AI detection, we're able to warn drivers if they're not paying attention of things that's in the drive path as well as nearby. So hopefully we're making them safe. And also the AI navigation tells them exactly where to go, so you don't have to look at the map. Whereas you're looking at the actual road, and your navigation route is the one that's
safe.
Right. So, for example, you might be missing a stop sign, but I know people crossing the street you're not aware of, or maybe cyclists that's next to you that you're not paying attention to. What things are going on?
So,
none of
this is my reference. It's all
cameras. Yes, exactly. And that's what differentiates us because our breakthrough allows extremely efficient development. So, only camera sensors using commodity.
So, recording is so good.
It's just a camera. It's a cigarette lighter.
So, and it's interview display for the aftermarket, or is it a smart display, or is it?
No, so right now we're aiming to show on the smart device, but you can place your smart device in front of you or outside of you, otherwise you wouldn't buy it. Yes. But we're also looking into protection base. But then right now, protection base has its own problems in terms of power consumption. So, we're focusing on that.
What's the kind of draw the back vision?
Absolutely. So we're part of the fund that we're raising is for collecting my data that allows us to perform the information.
Okay.
So I'm Sandy Ayosa, the co-founder of Dining Motors, and we're making advanced electric vehicle proposals. We have a good hard look at the future of our market. We're looking for 4 tiers to go up. Affordable price, long range, quick charging, and amazing performance. Manufacturers today have some, but not all of them. Nobody's been able to really get all these vehicles, but everyone is handling them. So what's holding back the future though? Clearly, it's battery development. Batteries just haven't been used to this market. We look at the market as a negative correlation between price and weight. So more range and more decay soon in the vehicle. We've inverted that equation through the development of the most energy dense, the most affordable batteries. So that new battery pack merges revolutionary modular packing architecture with advanced proprietary materials. Combined with the highest energy density cells on the market and with advanced passive cooling system, we have the highest energy density and lowest price on the market today. So then, for the real world example, think of Tesla Model S. The Model S currently uses a 9 kWh, $32,000 battery pack. Drive around 250 miles. A similar vehicle using our technology would require about half the size and would drive over 350 miles. That's less weight and price to a significant amount. We use the same type of Tesla pack, we can hit over 700 miles, still at a lower cost than Tesla Model S. Overall, we offer three advantages: lower weight, lower price, and higher price. So, how do we consider the cost of OTEC hardware? At $200 per kilowatt hour, we offer the lowest pack price. In fact, we only have that at Tesla. At 350 miles of range, we offer the highest range, quadrupling that of the world's best-selling Nissan. Our app is also good for our people, offering 150 miles in only 15 minutes. We also offer 3G differentials to our business on the market today. We're targeting three distinct verticals: automotive, energy storage, and energy transport. Each of these three verticals will produce a lot of growth in the next decade, specifically around electric vehicles. We are currently working with some of the market leaders in the space, including Nissan and others, to integrate our technology with these. The future of EVs is bright. Even if we only capture 0.5% of the market by 2025, the rapid growth of the EV space, specifically in China, will allow us to enter the 4 billion companies. The technology of cars in the future isn't built on what's going on. Our team comprises expertise of over 60 plus combined years in automotive manufacturing, operations, as well as hardware engineering itself. In only a year, we've accomplished what typically takes nearly 4 years of manufacturing and new vehicle development in a major OEM. We plan to continue this and continue to our next phase. We're currently raising that. With it, we plan $3.5 million. With it, we plan to complete our patents, demonstrate our technology in an existing vehicle taxi, grow our team, and demand additional capital. We look forward to the future of high power and high rate of affordable electric vehicles. Thank you for your time.
Judges?
So, let's keep it very little flashback sometime. Is the chemistry, the battery chemistry we talked about there from those just like mine? Is it sodium error or is it?
We're not using chemistry.
Just battery.
We're packaging technology, right? So when we're currently the cells that are on the market are here in higher density, they're actually higher enough they're meant to reach the specs. The difference is that in a vehicle, when you have a package for cooling and safety, you get about 2 to 4 times extra cost than we just to put it into the vehicle.
But it turns out the car companies are careful.
Of course. Every gram of vehicle made directly for all the
same
reason. Right, so our pack, one of the three different differentiators that we offer, is actually complete fire protection. So our material will put out fire or short if they call it the same. It's completely
fire.
Yes.
What's it based on?
So we developed an advanced polymer that passively wicks away heat from the cells. This allows us to passively cool the pack. On top of that, there our modularity and our passive cooling system and our active cooling system that we apply all add up to increase the value. We've been full testing, we have full working models working on that. So we have an active cooling component, also proprietary, that cools around during points of high discharge or high charge. So when the charging is okay, that active cooling component comes up because it doesn't really affect.
I'm not even having that opportunity to do it. I don't know, 15 minutes or 7 hours.
So you have to talk to the company that they're working with.
You can just finish the sentence.
Their technology is still on the lab, so that technology doesn't actually exist on the mobile app.
Okay, thank you very much.
Butcher, my name is.
Okay, Dan, you say it then.
Hi, everyone. My name is Tom Grill. I'm the founder and CEO of One of the things that excites me most about traveling through the city is being able to email it. In fact, before I go on one of these adventures, I start imagining myself walking through open air street markets, eating the food, smelling the roads, having the adventures with locals in the building market. Unfortunately, 99% of the time, I found myself overpaying for crap food at a tourist trap. Now, why does that keep happening? Why is it so difficult for travelers to find a truly authentic local cuisine? Well, for one thing, there's a single online platform that I use to send takes hours upon hours of future research to find people who can remotely. Culture gaps also play a role. If you don't speak the local language, chances are you're not meeting with the locals. Finally, we're afraid. We're afraid of venturing out from tourist centers, we're afraid of getting ripped off, we're afraid of getting food poisoning and Chinese food. We're afraid. And that's exactly why we're afraid of food. Fruition is a marketplace platform that connects travelers with super passionate local food guides in 75 international cities. Our marketplace provides a seamless ecosystem for travelers to search and book these experiences and for guides to list and manage their tours. Not only do we put a lot of effort into technology in our future, we also ensure that it's at the forefront of a booming market. The Colorado tourism market is estimated at $150 billion annually in its growth abroad. Moreover, 80% of American travelers are spending more on food and beverage than any other expenditure while they're traveling, more in accommodation, more in flights. We do have our fair share of competitors within the experiential travel space, three main differences between us and them. For one thing, we're the only ones concentrating on public experiences, and I just talked about how we create that market. Secondly, we're the only ones who have a true guide vetting system, three background checks in order to ensure that everybody is safe and the experience is the highest quality. Finally, the combination is absolutely price gouging. That's taking 25 to 30% margins on each booking that's being made on the platforms that goes to our platform center. We launched Food Trip in April 2016. We have 280 active guys on the platform today, 20% month-over-month growth there, and as I mentioned, 75 international cities. 6,000 active monthly users, we're seeing a 15% growth month-over-month there, and $3,000 a month in return revenue. Our team is made up of four New York-based team members, all with vast experience in travel tech, user acquisition, e-commerce, etc. We're currently raising $850,000 in order to get 250,000 active monthly users to the platform, 5,000 active guys, and $50,000 in monthly recurring revenues. Guys, next time you travel to Shanghai, Tokyo, Belgium, don't be a schmuck against local McDonald's. Talk to me after this presentation. I'll hook you with your very own food trip so you too can start eating with local McDonald's. Thank you.
Judges.
So there are a number of international, increasingly domestic stuff. They don't have to try to make international trip reputations here in the front of this stuff. Why could they be a recent partner in the sense that there's a group of people who would just be happy to play with this sort of map to survive? There's some good partners in that. They might be willing to do something like this or be pretty friends or both.
They're absolutely friends. So a collaboration with friends like that is exposure for us, it's additional income for us. We have existing partners in many different domains, whether it's a hospitality brand, digital, itinerary providers, etc. All of those are definitely friends. The ones I'm talking about specifically are experiential travel platforms like Spider. They're folks. And they're folks for a few reasons. They're folks because they don't believe in the high quality product that we're selling. They'd rather have Red Bus, New York tours on their platform. If you want to buy their buildings, then you have New York. The amount of crap that you see on it, the hodgepodge of varying degree tours, are definitely not resonating with our
company
driver. So, okay,
actually, restaurants.
Sure. Absolutely. So, that's the next step, actually.
So, I'm trying to figure out what you're down to rate. You're making a local into a culinary curator for anybody who wants to go in based on their taste.
Absolutely.
Right, so I've got lots of friends, big social media members, and some of the associates when I come to town. Why is it that I need as good as what you're doing?
Excellent question. So we honestly believe that when you go to a new country, a new city, you actually breaking bread with a local far more of a connection to the leash.
That's what I need to do. That's what that I would do.
Right, my friend. So not everybody has to be. We're very popular with that. And not everybody has to. I'm a solo traveler from a woman traveler going to Vietnam for the first time. I am very, very much seeking some experience which will allow me to connect with the local culture and don't necessarily have the things that are on the ground, and it's exactly what I'm.
Okay, thank you very much.
Hi, everybody. My name is Sean, founder and CEO of Vera. We use technology to improve life insurance distribution and money. The life insurance industry is growing. The average sales agent is 50 years old. Underwriting can take over 2 months and cost over $300. Vera improves underwriting and distribution. We bring life insurance online, selling through B2C and B2B channels. Our technology collects over 20,000 data points, including more accurate medical data and newer and better sources of financial and behavioral data. Our machine learning algorithms can decrease the cost and time required for underwriting. In other words, we are better, faster, and cheaper. Now, other insurance companies in the States, because of the likes of technology and channel confidence, they all try to innovate by partnering with startups. And the other startups in the States, namely Ladder, Haven, and Fabric, they all serve the same concept, while all of them target young public clients. On the other hand, Vera targets higher worth applicants, including those who smoke, have medical conditions, or have a history of illness. These applicants actually comprise up to 50% of the population. They pay higher premiums for their life insurance, they're more willing to share more data, and they actually need life insurance the most. And we're initially starting with a $175 billion U.S. life insurance market and plan to license our technology to other markets with low insurance penetration, including China. And Europe's ultimate vision is to be able to measure the true risk of anyone, anywhere, anytime. So where are we now? So if you can already go to mirrorfinancial.com and get life insurance prices and apply for them online. We have a distribution partnership with Tom. We're able to sell life insurance already for 10 insurance companies. We're already in discussions with a global reinsurance company to build our and partner on our enterprise. And we also recently began to raise our seed round for up to $1 million. And last but not least, we also have our team of leaders. I formerly co-founded Monica, which raised equity for $2 million awards and is now partnering with banks to issue credit cards. I also attended Work MBA and Work MBA Fest. My partner, Ivar, was a senior software engineer at an insurance company building their apps. And he's also published new papers in artificial intelligence. So, we are here. My name is Sean, and let's work together.
Okay. Judges, questions?
So, in this area, a couple of my partners have spent a lot of time on this. So, but I do know in general, investing a lot of distribution within insurance, specifically life insurance, is very mainline insurance to compete with their existing. The second is, of course, is because they just want to
yeah.
The can do is starting to deal with those two issues.
Well, the channel conflict, so we actually partner with many insurance companies and we're acting as what's called an MGA or MGA. And so our distribution model, we can sell direct to the consumer, or we can also have sub-agencies under us selling on the arm wall. Or we can also buy the client applicants through the companies like Ladder, Haven, and to the insurance companies, actually, this isn't too much of a channel conflict because they can create a specific product that is and that will fall under different pricing, also different sort of mortality and all these data
umbrellas. It's really a trend of sort of origination of product that is non-traditional, actually, et cetera, and those are the sweet spot that you're talking about, like edges, and a pricing accordingly, I assume, and therefore naturally why you don't have any markets.
Exactly. So we are targeting people who are higher risk initially, a smaller audience, and we're able to collect more accurate medical information as well as behavioral and financial information to more accurately underwrite them and deliver them faster and cheaper, and
And so that is the solution that companies will have. And so they're not really providing for other agents for the other issues.
So what are you solving? You're solving a better price, better insurance policy?
To the insurance carrier, better price, faster, more automated, and in all sides of the area, we're also able to discover more after.
Okay, thank you. Michael, Square Teams.
Hi, everyone. I'm Rebecca Frankel, and I'm the founder and CEO of Square Teams. Square Teams is team building for the millennial age. We built a machine learning algorithm to generate optimal teams. The process of forming teams in the workplace is about to be disrupted. Tony Hsieh, the CEO of Zappos, said that his past bad hires has cost his company well over $100 million. Wrong hires is a multi-billion dollar problem in the United States as well as in China. And in general, in many cases, they're wrong hires because they don't fit in well with the teams to which they were assigned. So our sophisticated recommender system actually filters job candidates based not only on core skills, but on soft skills as well, like personality, tenacity, creativity. We use the MDP multidimensional profile of each person, of each job candidate, and we calibrate it to fit in with the MDPs of the existing team members. HR, $400 billion is spent each year globally on HR. We're optimizing the process. If we capture even 1% only of the market, that's $4 billion. But we're actually anticipating growth because we're expanding the features of what we offer. Our business model is multi-transactional licensing fees. We're also doing monthly subscription fees. We also have a university student app, which connects students, a mobile app, which connects university students across disciplines and across campuses to do projects or startups. And companies would pay monthly subscription fees to post internships or job openings and do team-based hiring or individual hiring. We recruited Jeff Burton, one of the founders of Electronic Arts, EA Sports, to our board of advisors. Our CTO, Sam Buchik, is computer whiz, who's led technical teams for a number of successful startups. A recent one, Reversely, was acquired by Apple. And, what else?
Okay, that's good. Judges, questions?
So you're in the recruiting business?
Well, not really. We're in the team generating business, and we're applying it. One of the applications is for recruitment. One is to amplify our education.
And you recruit and try and find that person, and you try and match them with the culture.
Yeah.
May I have your attention? Yeah. We're conducting a test of the building's fire alarm system.
Wow.
Please disregard any alarms you will see or hear. I repeat, we're testing the building's fire alarm system. Please disregard any alarms you will see or hear. An announcement will be made when testing has been completed.
This is really our joke about the end of Silver Dragon. This is our program today.
For PPMG, they get a number, let's say 100 job candidates for a job. We filter them and we tell them to be best for the teams for which job candidates would be assigned.
Data is coming primarily from the application, is scraping data.
No, we develop our own personality test that the incoming job candidate has to take, plus whatever they normally traditionally would get. Well, we also have the ability to scrape them.
Are they all different?
No, we're going to give the new one also to the existing employees to be able to match them appropriately, and we wanted to run some enough self-assessments or more amplification because we see our plans more accurately reflects person's personality.
Okay, thank you very much. As I mentioned, I was really hoping we would be
we're actually 1 million on $10 million top track.
Okay, and that's it. I'm sorry, we have to go now.